came back a little light of persuasion. Bangles round your neck. You came back with the nation captured in full silhouette, where the women speak in whispers once the tourists are asleep, and the future sits in shadows, tonguing brand new sets of teeth. Discontents and memories have hardened to a tangle in their chests. The women, they hold the line and sweep violence from the door. Future was moderate, but now it's calling out for war. Oh, 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 oh. Silhouetted by the sun. And you told yourself you better go see the world while you still. Rebels took the bridges out the day after you left town. Just try and tell them this is the end of history. They are driven by the promises of brand new centuries. Oh, 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 oh. Nation silhouetted by the sun.
Thanks very much. Thanks for listening.
Another a round of applause for Corbin Murdoch. Plays with Nautical Miles. He's a graduate of SFU and the managing producer of Theater Replacement. Delighted you could join us for the fifth annual Jim Green Memorial Lecture. My name is Am Johal. I'm director of SFU's Van City Office of Community Engagement. I wanted to begin by acknowledging that we're on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh. This is the fifth year we've done this since Jim passed away. The very first year, Ken Liotier, the founder of United We Can, gave the first lecture. Bob Williams, who's with us tonight, gave a lecture on social innovation in second year. And Jeff Meggs, Vancouver City Councillor, gave a talk with a panel on Jim's social housing legacy with a view of looking at the present and the future. And last year, as Corbin mentioned, we did a stage reading of Against the Tide, a book that Jim wrote in the mid-80s, the history of the Canadian Seamen's Union. Delighted to be having a speaker like Ashley Proctor talk about 312 Main Street. Just to give you a little bit overview of the evening, after Ashley finishes speaking, we'll be going immediately to the reception on the ground floor. So if you do have any questions for her, she'll be there until about 10 p.m. Or so. We also have special guests, Vanessa Richards and the Woodward's Community Singers, who will be joining us at the reception, and you guys will all be participating in the music as well. Here to get things kicked off, I'd like to ask you to join me in welcoming two board members with the Jim Green Foundation, Alexandra Rutherford, Jim's daughter, and Bob Williams. Welcome.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. It's always bittersweet, I have to say, honest, to be coming here tonight. It's 5 years, as Anne mentioned, since my dad passed away. And tonight in particular, this what you'll be hearing Ashley speak about is extremely exciting. A few months after my dad passed away, we got together, a few of us, of his closest friends, and led by Bob Williams, but also joined by Amjo Hall, Mauro Vissera, Elvi Del Bianco, Thomas Bevan, David Cookson, to rally and say, what are we going to do to honor Jim? And what is the one project that he wanted to see happen in this city, and in particular in the downtown east side, that he had been speaking of for several years? So this 312 Main project is 5 years in the making, and I won't, I don't think I'll be understating it by saying it's been an uphill battle the whole way, but we are very excited to be just a few months away from opening doors. Ashley will give you all the details on that. What I wanted to introduce, we'll share with you a 4-minute video that we filmed throughout 2015. So it's about a year and a half old. The very talented Colin Askey interviewed us in the space in 312 Main, asking us what the original sentiment was behind the vision for this. What did Jim aspire to see happen in this Center for Social Innovation? So you'll hear us speaking to that. You'll also see in this video, which we'll share in just a minute, in the background, some moving pictures and video of a smudging ceremony that also happened in 2015. That was the beginning of our working with the local First Nations community to honor the space, recognize the history of the space, of the cop shop that we were taking over and transforming. A really powerful experience to be there. Councillor Reimer was also in attendance and can attest to just how emotional that afternoon was. So you'll see some footage from that. But it was really a cleansing experience and a new beginning, I think. And we're just kind of on the cusp of seeing the that come to life. So that's the video that you'll see in just a minute. I invite Bob Williams, who's been our fearless leader, to introduce Ashley Proctor.
Thanks, Alexandra. Just to pick up on that ceremony that occurred with a shaman from the Musqueam Reserve, what he had to say, and you'll see it in some of our pamphlets here at the very end, and as he danced around the drums and there was the chanting and singing, and this was a 4-hour ceremony that we all had the privilege of attending, the shaman said, "The building is now cleansed." And as he danced, he showed some of the beatings he had taken in that very jail himself. And then he said, "It is now cleansed and ready to do your good work. It is now a grandmother greeting you to do good work in this old building." So it really was us getting on our way. Jim would be so excited if he'd known that an idea of his from 10 years ago had finally got to this point. And we have to credit all the players, and this is a lease from the City of Vancouver. It's for which we are thankful. And it's one of the ugliest buildings in the city. I'm an old city planner, but I see it as ugly, and I think most people that used it saw it as ugly. So we had an Italian professor here one summer through Van City that taught us some things about the arts in this city. And he said, you know, there's also capital, and there's you know, financial capital, there's human capital, there's social capital. But then he said, there's also symbolic capital. And a lot of us hadn't thought about that. And this building, in, if anything, is symbolic capital. It looks kind of Stalinist. It's 1954 heritage in Vancouver, and it's going to be under new management, and this kind of management Jim was looking for. We were hunting for the right person to handle this mixture that is a center for social innovation. Jim had urged me to visit 10 years ago in Toronto and see their center for social innovation, and it's excellent. But there's a tandem group that was doing interesting work as well, and in Toronto as well. And our first staffer, Thomas Bevan, ended up finding her as he reached out into different sessions around the world. And he found this Toronto gal, Ashley Proctor, in Lisbon and Berkeley, and he might have found her in Beijing. She was really talking up this dramatic new idea about co-working and how you could network and create human and social capital by the way you design the building and with the people you put in it. So once we met Ashley in Toronto and saw the work she was doing in a very difficult marketplace, here she was generating small studios for artists in the tough rental market of Toronto and making it work. So she was a kind of a private social entrepreneur that was serving artists. And we were mighty impressed because, I guess in my experience, finding artists that have a real business head at the same time is all too rare. And Ashley covers both sides of the brain dramatically. And then beyond that, we were asking to work in one of the toughest, crankiest neighborhoods in Canada. And it's this one right here. But, you know, it is the heart of the city. And we've been chunking around trying to find a name for the building, and it's sticking at 312 Main. But some of us hope that we can find a European First Nations Chinook name that might be attached to 312 Main as well. But Ashley has ended up doing her projects in Toronto, and the name of her organization was Creative Blueprints, which she still uses. And the people in Seattle were so impressed by her, they asked for Ashley's help down in Seattle. If some of you know Capitol Hill in Toronto, in Seattle, there's another project there, Nomads Co-working, a really interesting, exciting neighborhood place. She's she's acclimatized herself to our territory here. I'm overjoyed about it. She lives right here at Woodward's, and her shop is just up the street at Main Street. So she's learned to enjoy this part of the city with all its interest and opportunities. We're overjoyed. I'm pleased to introduce Ashley Proctor, the executive director of 312 Main. Ashley.
Let me just start at the beginning. It's an honor to be here tonight, to be invited to speak to you, to be part of this event, to be invited to lead this team, this project. I pinch myself almost every day to be involved in something of this magnitude and of this importance in this neighborhood. When I was first invited to speak tonight about cooperative social innovation and the global co-working movement and the 312 Main project in particular, I was also asked to speak about my work and the organizations and the projects that I founded and the collaborative movement that's building around the world as the future of work shifts and the community once again becomes central. I never got to meet Jim. But the more I learn about him and his work, the more heartbreaking that truth becomes. I really feel like his legacy is such an empowering one, and in learning more, it's truly inspired me to continue to dedicate myself to this project at 312 Main. It seems like we shared many of the same values, and I believe that he'd be pleased with the vision that this team has been working on to animate 312 Main. And I'll be sure to speak much more about that project in a bit, I promise. As I was preparing for this talk, I was speaking to Jim's family and friends, and one thing that stood out in everything that we chatted about was, let's talk about the work, let's talk about the values, let's tell the story. And rather than eulogize or dedicate, let's elevate the causes that he was passionate about. Let's talk about the mission and the vision we have. And I kept hearing over and over again, just talk, just tell your story, be yourself. It's what you know, and so I hope that you can find something meaningful in me sharing my story about my journey and how I ended up here working on this 312 Main project. So my story actually begins in Toronto, as Bob mentioned. I know, I'm sorry, but it's true. I first moved there 15 years ago from a small town to attend art school, and in a big city, I felt really disconnected, and I was looking to find a genuine community again, to be surrounded by people who really care. I was looking for a connection, for honesty, for engaged citizens. I wanted to be part of something bigger than myself, and the first place I found that in Toronto was Kensington Market. So that hometown, that small town feeling, that close-knit community, where there's an influx of travelers and guests and visitors, but the community itself was diverse and really culturally vibrant. It was a neighborhood within a larger city. And if you haven't been there, I can promise you that walking down the street, you would find every religion, ethnicity, language, interest, experience, flavor, anything you can imagine, side by side, peacefully, in one place. This neighborhood was all about inclusivity, about activism, about action. The citizens got together more than once to prevent gentrification. They prohibited Walmart, Nike, Starbucks, all with a few people deciding that this is how they wanted to keep their community independent. There are a lot of little projects that really inspired me while I was there, done by groups of residents, like the Kensington Community Garden. These murals and this food was an initiative by a few people who thought, the system's broken, let's fix it. The vehicular reclamation project is a key feature of Kensington Market. It's a comment on car culture, and it's the beginning of the pedestrian Sundays. Another thing about that place that really sticks with me is celebrating together. Even though we may have diverse interests, we all become fans and supportive of each other. And my favorite event of every year is the Festival of Lights, where we celebrate the solstice as a group. We come together, and we ignite the longest, darkest night. This was my neighborhood. This was my starting point. And this is all still at my core. So as I mentioned, I was going to art school at the Ontario College of Art and Design. And the project that we were experiencing was called Superbuild. The government assured us that this was going to be a good thing. And as a student, though, what we found is that we were losing our space. We were losing our gathering spaces. We were losing our co-located spaces, our shared studios, our exhibition spaces, our offices, our lounges. All the casual spaces that we would meet and connect were being taken away as this project was being implemented. So I became a representative on the student union. And my job then became to solve the problems that the students were bringing to me lacking these resources. So we created a board of representatives. And even though the administration told us it would be possible to fund or to maintain, we secured $60 from every single student that year. And we created our own student-funded, student-run space called X-Space. It's the first one of its kind in Canada. And it served the need of artists who were looking for a community hub. They needed somewhere to produce, to sell their work, to celebrate together, to fundraise, to educate, to gather, and to connect with their neighborhood. It really became a hub of collaboration. XSpace was all about accessible and affordable space for artists and entrepreneurs. It was a bridge, it was a community access point where people could meet us out in the neighborhood. That's where it got the name, the external space, XSpace. It's also the place where P.S. Kensington was born, as the first fundraiser was held there at XSpace 14 years ago. P.S. Kensington is when you shut down the streets on the Sunday, one Sunday every month, and the streets become for the people. So 14 years later, both XSpace and P.S. Kensington are still around today. But in the midst of this creation, this project, as much as it filled me up and thrilled me to be working in this area, my life changed in an entire, it was an instant actually, my life just changed in an instant. I was riding my bike to school and I slipped on some grease, and the way I fell left me with injuries that were pretty impactful and lasting. I basically had to learn how to do everything again. My mobility was taken away from me, my independence, my identity. The injuries made it difficult to walk, and I was in a very physical program, and I liked to ride my bike or walk to school, and so things had to change for me pretty quickly. But as I was navigating all of that and trying to get back on my feet, I lost my job. I lost my student status. I couldn't complete my program at OCAD. I lost my car. I lost my apartment. Because I lost my student status, I also lost my health and dental insurance, which is key, because that's really all I needed at the time to get back on my feet. I lost some friends, I lost mobility, and I lost some hope. The whole experience taught me a lot. It really impacted me. It got me thinking about a lot of other systems that were broken and a lot of things that needed to change. I spent a lot of time at the food bank. I spent some time in a shelter. I spent some time relying on the generosity of family and friends in my community to pick me back up. But what it also did was inspire me. It inspired me to make every day count. It inspired me to take the leap to start my company, even though I was having trouble walking and I only had $50. But I was hearing from so many people that something like an organization to help each other navigate this market, to understand how to exist in this new workforce where we don't have benefits and we don't have full-time employment and we don't have the opportunities that a school system or a shared studio would provide when we get into the real world. So in a roundabout way, this accident actually motivated me to launch Creative Blueprint. And so in 2006, around the same time, I believe that Bob was visiting the Center for Social Innovation in Toronto. We began with a group of 30 artists. And we were determined that we were going to come up with some solutions for things like precarious and temporary income. And we were going to come up with solutions for health and dental insurance for independent workers. And we were going to help people navigate this new workforce. The first venue we did, we created Artist Work Studios, where you could share facilities, share equipment. And again, the important part here was that we maintain affordable and accessible space in a neighborhood that was quickly gentrifying. And as many of you know, this happens a lot with artists and arts groups. We really needed to plant a flag and to hang on to this space within the neighborhood as everything swirled around us. And through all this, we decided to continue providing services and supports for those artists and entrepreneurs. We were building significant connections and building a network. And at the same time, the Center for Social Innovation was growing next to us. We started realizing that this was a community, this is something that we shared, even though one took the form of art and one took the form of a shared workplace. We had a lot of goals, we had some common operations as well. At CSI, they shared investment and equipment, they shared services and staff and their facilities, their workspace, their meeting rooms. And they were also developing a conscious shared culture. This is the part that appealed to me the most. And so we thought more about how we could combine the arts and a collaborative workspace like CSI so that we could encourage artists and entrepreneurs, freelancers, and creative people to develop a self-sustaining, rewarding practice. Through all of our plans, we recognized that these people, as well as the community members and residents, needed to be valued and encouraged and recognized in the markets that they contributed so vibrantly to. We needed to create a supportive network of resources to encourage the independent and sustainable growth. And our members were asking us for really basic things like a place to exhibit their work, to sell their work, to learn, to teach, to share. We wanted to ensure that we created something that wasn't reliant on grants or ongoing funding. It was truly self-sustainable, self-directed learning, and that all the members had input into the programming. And so remember that accident? Well, while I was getting back on my feet in the Artist Health Center, I was staring out the window a lot. I was kind of trapped in this room. A lot of recovery, physiotherapy, and the pain clinic, and I had the view, the same view, for 3 years. And I would stare at this building and think about all the potential, all the things I could do if only I could walk, if only I had the right partners, if only I had the right investment, if only we had the right team. This was the view from that window. And this is the beginning of Foundry. So I saw endless potential in this building. I was daydreaming. And by the time I actually built up the nerve and the strength to walk across the street and knock on the door, a year had passed. There was an F on the door with a little flame, and I had no idea what was happening inside and couldn't really see much of anything happening. But then I was introduced to the owner of this building, Jake. The first thing he told me is he was building a coworking community here, and I was heartbroken. He had already decided that he was going to build this project and the one exactly I had been dreaming of. But one thing he hadn't considered was the integration of the arts, and so we had a couple of interesting conversations, and we chose collaboration over competition. Foundry was reborn that day. Foundry is a co-working and event space, and it came out of a conversation about hacking capitalism, about changing the system. Yes, it's co-working and events, but Foundry is a place for starting things. It's a place where you work for yourself, but not by yourself. And it's a true partnership. It's really not possible without Jake deciding that he wanted to work on this with me. Foundry is a place where you take ideas and you put that with action and you turn it into impact. It's all in one space, and so we added the arts in via Creative Blueprint and the Foundry buildings were born. To do this, we needed some creative blueprints. There was consultation as well with the community, and so we asked them what they need, what their goals are, what they value. And most people said that they wanted the design to encourage connection and outreach to the neighborhood, and so we started working outside. One of the key features here is the accessibility of the space, and rather than it being a prohibitive block in front of the space, we did a welcoming entrance. It's not just physical accessibility as well, it's financial. It's a welcoming and inclusive space. It's anything and anyone being welcome. And all they have to do is respect the others in the community, and so we kept building. This is a final product at Foundry, and it seems very simple, but this is an important transition in the neighborhood. There's no greenery in this neighborhood. There's nowhere to sit down. There's nowhere to have a conversation off of the sidewalk, and now there is. And that's actually been the beginning of many of those conversations, like the one Jake and I had that very first day at Foundry. The building itself, the model is important. This is something we're recreating in 312 Main, and the important part to note is that the options within the building are set up for maximum flexibility, for diversity. It's to support the demands of a new workforce. There are private offices, there are shared open workspaces, there are meeting rooms. You have to be able to get your work done first and foremost, or else nobody's going to be there day after day. But beyond that, we have a chance to integrate the arts and activism. We use the arts to educate and to inform. We use the arts to connect people. And most importantly, we use the arts to inspire and to empower. The event space in the building is one of the most important elements as well. These just show a few examples: Music Ontario workshops, partnerships with colleges for exhibitions, grad shows. The very first feminist art conference was born at Foundry. We also used to host a monthly tech social where people who are involved in coding all day could come out and not talk shop, just meet each other, just make meaningful human connections. We would partner with others outside of the space to host meetups and events as well. And we would celebrate. We would have fun together. We would host live music. There would be social events. We would network. We would make connections. There were even a few weddings in the space. And this was really important because we were starting to truly meet our neighbors and to become parts of their lives. The events and programming that we host in the space and the ones that we hope to carry through today are really important because of their impact. An event is not simply an opportunity to meet other people or to have a drink or to grab a bite of some free food, but there are so many themes and areas we can touch on just by hosting an event, and so we really need to think of it in those terms. Our events provide access to technology. They're about arts and culture. We talk about capacity building, community activism and community building, economic development, education and training, entrepreneurship and business development, fundraising initiatives, health and wellness programs, heritage languages, some incubation and acceleration programs, and some just social or celebratory events. But all of these events are very thoughtful and carefully programmed to encourage serendipity, to encourage wellness, and to encourage the community. We weren't the only ones building a space like this. In Toronto, right now, there are probably 40 other spaces, co-working spaces, many of which we helped to start or helped to grow. So we decided, since you could walk to 7 spaces from ours, to work together again rather than to compete. So I founded the Co-working Toronto and Co-working Ontario collectives to show these values and to provide an opportunity for others to participate on a larger scale. So each of these spaces are independently owned and operated, but we share our values. We believe that we can achieve more by working together. We believe that we can accelerate our learning and education, that we share best practices to improve our own communities, and that collectively we can shape the future of work. We might even be able to launch a global movement. The co-working movement is also unique in that it's one of the few groups of people who formed organically in grassroots environments and ended up becoming an industry and now a movement. It's one of the few industries where people share everything. You can go online today and say, I'd like to start a space, and 100 people will help you do it. Everything is published. It's free and open. And we all collectively decided that there are core values of this movement, and that they are collaboration, community, sustainability, accessibility, and openness. I don't know another industry that can do this in such an organic and hopeful way, but it was really, really interesting to watch unfold over the years. So we started connecting with spaces outside of our city and across the province. Actually, I think there's a picture up here where you can see the Ontario folks in the corner doing a Skype call with me now here from Vancouver at the Network Hub. And we're also connecting with Alex Hillman, one of the pioneers of the co-working movement in the United States. But by deciding that we were going to work together, we started learning at an accelerated rate, and we started realizing that we had a lot of potential together. We had a lot of power in numbers. We were creating a new model and a new system. We were working municipally, provincially, and we were working across networks that we had never even imagined before. By collaborating and connecting with other groups, we learned that a lot of us were doing some pretty epic things. And one group in particular, CSI in Toronto, had a lead on the rest of us, having been at it for so long. They had a catalyst program, a catapult group. They had created a community bonds program, microloans, crowdfunding platforms. They were working with groups like the Tool Library. This was a scale at which we saw the impact of the sharing economy. And so these connections, these programs that we were developing, because we were all working together, we had a massive effect that we weren't quite aware we were about to have. And I remember that accident again. COHIP was one of the unintended results of that fateful event. COHIP is the first coworking health insurance plan. So I learned quickly that I wasn't the only one in need of affordable, accessible health and dental benefits as a self-employed artist and entrepreneur. I had a lot of clients and friends coming up to me through Creative Blueprint, and they would reveal to me that they were in jobs that they hated, but that they were hanging on so that they could have those employment benefits for their family and friends, or for their staff. They were hanging on to their insurance until one day, and they would say things like, if only I could. So, again, we need action for impact, and so we worked with all of the collaborative spaces across Canada, and now we can reach all artists and entrepreneurs, all freelancers, all small businesses, and independent workers across Canada. And when I came out here to Vancouver, I met someone else who was working on a very similar project. And I'm happy to say I've now partnered with Devon Carr here in British Columbia to make COHIP available to everyone, especially while I'm busy working on new projects. So if we can reach across the city, we can reach across the province, we can reach across the country, what else can we do together? We can collaborate on a global scale. And so I started working to bring people together to share in a conference setting, the Global Coworking Unconference Conference. It's not your typical conference, as you might be able to tell. And it was originally named out of a meetup group that came out of South by Southwest as an ode to Stephen Colbert more than 7 years ago. I didn't name it. But GCUC, or Juicy, as it's now become known, happens all over the world. I produce Juicy Canada. And as I said, it's not a typical conference. It's not a typical industry. This is true disruption. These are real change makers. These are dreamers. And so we get together on the same path that we had as those independent operators, and we share. We might be known as the Kumbaya crowd, or it's the community building conference. But one thing we are known for sure is that it's our Canadian values. And the key ones are that diversity is our strength. Also that we are inclusive and cooperative, and that we're building a movement. People truly look to Canadian coworking for leadership in this movement, and it's something that I feel like we haven't really stepped up and owned yet. I feel like we might begin to do that at 312 Main. One of the beautiful things about this movement is you get to connect with people all over the world. And because of that, we've begun producing these conferences all over the world. And so now I help to produce Juicy in a different country every month. And we've got to host these events in Austin, Kansas City, Berkeley, Los Angeles, Shanghai, Brussels, Berlin, Bali, Paris, Barcelona, Chiang Mai, Lisbon, Milan, Sydney, Beijing, Toronto, Montreal, and Juicy will be coming to Vancouver in October. Because of the opportunity to produce these events around the world, I get to speak to a lot of different groups. I get to tour a lot of co-working spaces and creative communities and collaborative hubs. I've been to more than 500 different ones. And one thing that's really interesting is that whether you're at Office Nomads in Seattle or if you're in HITalk in Beijing, it still really comes down to those meaningful human connections. It's about people. It's about measurable impact. With coworking, it's not just about productivity and happiness and the health and the growth. It's those meaningful human connections that make you go back. It's not a desk. It's not Wi-Fi. You can do that anywhere. You can work from a coffee shop. You can work from home. People want to be together because they share those values. That's one thing that the new corporate version of coworking misses out on, the executive suites and the business centers. They forget about the easiest part, which is people first. Now, at these conferences, as I mentioned, you get to meet a lot of people, and I happened to make one of those connections myself when I first met Thomas Bevan at Coworking Europe in Lisbon. I thought he was a little crazy. He had a pile full of drawings and this story about a cop shop. And it was a terrible building. It was going to be really difficult, and could I help him? I said, I don't think so. But I started to take him seriously when I saw him again in Berkeley with a new stack of drawings and a stronger vision and the same dedication to the cause. I thought, maybe there is actually a group that's serious enough to make this happen. So I sat down for a listen. Through him, I got to meet a big part of the 312 main team at the time, and together, we got to explore a new vision for a center for social and economic innovation in Vancouver. Now, the team has changed over the years, and the vision has gotten more and more clear. But to really dive in and to explore this, I had to jump in. I had to truly become a part of the team and of this community. So I had to make the leap. And 1 year ago today, I put my other projects in good hands, and I moved to Vancouver to get to work. I did this pretty quickly and without really asking, but I packed up my family and my pug Lou, and we moved to Vancouver, and it rained for the next month straight. Luckily, I ended up right here at Woodward's, and living here, I began to learn more about Jim and his work and projects like this one. I learned more about Blade Runners and the Portland Hotel Society and Four Corners Community Savings, and I was really inspired. What I love about this neighborhood and what I love about being at Woodward's is, although it's not perfect and I know it's a work in process, the community really is here. I mean, you're all here. The values are here. People make meaningful human connections here. And whether it be through dance or through music, I'm starting to see this common space be animated in a way that I think Jim would start to be proud of. People sharing community meals, celebrating in an inclusive space, connecting really meaningfully, sharing moments. I see a lot of diversity living here and a lot of inclusivity. And I chose this neighborhood because it was one of the realest, the rawest, and the most authentic places I could find. The dreamers are here. And so this has been a quote that's been important to me for a long time, and I'm going to read it for you now. Be around the dreamers and the doers and the thinkers and the believers, the people who are up to big and bold things in life. They wholeheartedly believe that what you're up to is just as brilliant and beautiful. They constantly challenge you to see more, to say more, to feel more, to love more, to be more. These people are the light bringers. These people are the magic makers. These people are the world shifters. These people are your tribe. And once you've found them, you have the greatest gift you can ever hope for. I recognize that dreamer spirit here in the downtown east side that I once knew in Kensington. I see that potential. I see the activism. I see the dedication to this community. The dreamers are here. They live here, they work here, they choose to be here. And we have a real opportunity to share the resources and to increase our impact. So we're working with the Dreamers. And there is complexity when you're working with residents and activists and artists and entrepreneurs and freelancers and small business and family-run business and service organizations and community groups, and you're trying to make it work for everyone. There's going to be some conflict. There is complexity. But with a commitment to collaborative social innovation and the impact we can have, almost anything is possible. And as you saw in the video, there is much work to be done to achieve this vision, the one that Jim originally had of a vibrant center for social and economic innovation here at 312 Main. And it did begin with a partnership, with a commitment, with a collaboration between the Jim Green Foundation and the Van City Community Foundation and the City of Vancouver. The best way, though, to advocate for cooperative social innovation is to put your time and your money where your mouth is. And these groups, along with SFU's Van City Office of Community Engagement, did just that. And if the system is broken, you have to start by acknowledging that before you begin to build. And as you saw, Shane Point graciously performed a traditional Indigenous cleansing ceremony in the building. And during his work, he came to realize that the spirit of the building is now one of a grandmother. This is a significant change to an embracing, comforting space of teaching full of goodness and positive energy. And for me, this is when the vision for the space really started to become clear. We're building a global center for economic and social innovation rooted in Vancouver's inner city. 312 Main will become home to a dynamic community of entrepreneurs, artists, and organizations that are committed to economic and social democracy, empowering one another and the neighborhood that they're part of to thrive. Collectively, we're going to break down barriers. A creative union will emerge out of the diverse mix of members and the interests. Our members will value collaboration over competition, working towards ambitious and measurable social and economic impact. And I truly believe that the space will be admired as a symbol of excellence and of transformative and restorative change in the Downtown Eastside community and around the world. The values here are really important to note. It's not just a project. It's the impact that we're thinking about every day. And with every decision we make, we're not just thinking about a pilot program. We're short-term, we're thinking 30 years and more, and we're thinking about what we're leaving behind as a legacy. We're thinking about creating really dynamic and inclusive community space, an inspiring and tolerant and accessible environment where everyone is welcome and challenged to engage in the work. We're also creating low-barrier space for the low-income community. And diversity truly is our strength here. We aim for a diverse range of age, socioeconomic status, experience, gender, language, culture. We want this to be a truly diverse community that's not just lip service. We encourage a mix of new and established organizations, individuals, and large teams. We can all learn something from each other. The important part to note is that in community building, it's about people first. This is community engagement. We're creating opportunity, we are creating community impact, and we're supporting growth and making a project that's sustainable. In creating this vision for the future of the space, we're imagining what it could be, and there are some things that we aim to achieve through the project. Construction is now underway in the space. And this is ridiculously exciting if you've been watching the project over the last 5 years to see these changes visibly and physically in the space. It lights me up when I walk through the door. I should note that the project will actually be financially self-supporting, and we're reinvesting all the surpluses from the project back into the building so that the members and the community at large will benefit from this space for a long time to come. This is because of a strong business model, and We're sure that this project is going to exist into the future without this ongoing financial support beyond the renovation and launch phase. So let me tell you a bit more about the details of the project. Let's dive right in. On the main floor, we're committed to providing open, accessible, porous, warm, and inviting space. We're adding a new accessible ramp and entrance on Cordova Street. And the main floor will be open to the public between, say, 8 and 8 every day. When you walk in the door, you'll be welcomed by greeters. There's open cafe-style seating. And an important element is that there are accessible, gender-neutral public washrooms. That's really key in this community, and it means a lot to the people who have asked for that. To give you an idea of the design, the main floor was inspired by Coast Salish longhouse design principles, and this gathering space here was designed by Nancy Mackin. The gathering space features the longhouse, a local cafe, a kitchen, and lounge. But we're also committed to providing free Wi-Fi and access points for community members that might not have access traditionally. Along the wall in the green, you can see some of the meeting rooms, which are open to members and also to external groups. There are event spaces in the middle and along the side, training rooms, which can hold 60, 70, and 300 people. But to ensure that these spaces are accessible to the community groups and the residents that we intend to serve, as well as the members, we've also created a programming fund. And in our first year alone, we plan to donate over $150,000 worth of space to the community at large. Also on this floor, we have a gallery in the event space. We need to show the importance of arts and culture in this building, and we will through our exhibitions, which some are permanent, some are rotating. We're going to host a multitude of exhibitions, receptions, music events, poetry readings, drum circles, heritage language classes, or workshops to do with the arts in this space. So because we're at the construction phase of this project, and you can see at the bottom here, we're building this accessible stage, which, again, you would think, many people would think of making a stage accessible. Often the venue is, but the stage itself isn't. As we're working through the construction here, we're still looking for partners. We're still looking for other interested parties. And so if something catches your mind, this would be a great idea. This would be a great community group to talk to. This is just the beginning. And we invite people to step up. The basement of the space is where we have our bike storage to encourage people to ride to work, and some end-of-trip facilities, including some showers and change rooms. But the core of the basement level is really about the artist studios, the production facilities, the maker space, the sound studios, and the shared common core. This area is generally for people working with their hands or small tools or testing prototypes. They might be painting, they might be sewing, they might be creating a podcast. But it's affordable, accessible space to make things. And this ties in well to our second floor plan. This is the heart of the building. This is our co-working community. And so there'll be a constant buzz of activity here as well. We have permanent desks and hot desks. Again, designed to maximize flexibility, to present some affordable options, to reduce expenses for these groups who are looking to increase their access to some shared resources. The design is to reduce their private footprint and to increase collaboration. Really, the design is meant to accelerate serendipity. So there are small private offices. There are shared kitchens and washrooms. There's communal coffee and internet and some shared support services in the space as well, all designed to encourage groups to increase capacity and to thrive. But if you haven't been in a co-working space before, you need to know that the design is to increase connection and collaboration. We're working with local designers, we're sourcing local materials wherever possible, We're using the space to facilitate the vision. The vision is really to spread the model and the core values of this co-working space throughout the building, and to truly create Canada's largest and most inclusive co-working community. The third to sixth floor will be reserved for larger organizations and groups in a co-location model. So it's an expansion of the co-working concept. There are still shared meeting rooms and kitchens and lounges, but the groups are larger. They need a little bit more privacy and autonomous space. And in a way, we're sort of teaching them how to fit into a co-working model. They also have access to all the shared amenities on the main floor, the event spaces, and the co-working community. This design really encourages growth within the building. So we're retaining our talent, and we're strengthening the community here in Vancouver. We're not incubating these spaces to leave. We're keeping them here. So it's really important at this point that we circle back and we re-engage our community partners and members as we did in the other projects. The photos here are from the Seattle project with Office Nomads and Creative Blueprint. But the important part to show is that we remain committed to this community consultation. It's an ongoing process, and we do this even after the doors are open, checking in with our members regularly to find out what it is they want and need. And here with this project, we're forming a cooperative model. So the 312 Main Community Co-op will be born to continue to govern and to direct the project, ensuring our commitment to people over profit and to the vision that Jim had. Success for this project means building relationships and working alongside, in partnership, other successful community groups and projects in the neighborhood. We're not reinventing the wheel here. There's room for everyone. We're looking for others. We're looking for the dreamers who are doing those big and bold and beautiful things, making magic and shifting the world. Success for this project is a truly inclusive and diverse ecosystem where organizations, individuals, and ideas cross-pollinate, and where we naturally collaborate, where we support each other. We support each other to grow and to maintain healthy relationships within the neighborhood itself. And most importantly, success is for that, so that people understand that 312 Main is not a space we're building for you, it's a space we're building with you. And to date, over 250 different organizations have expressed interest in and have helped to shape this project. And as I said, it's only the beginning. This is the start. We need you. We need your organizations. We need your superstars, your artists, your freelancers, your activists. We need them to step up. We've been working for a really long time on the structure, on the sustainability, and now we get to envision again what kind of a space this is actually going to be. It's up to you, and this is a call to action. So tonight, I'm asking you to think about what's possible when we work collaboratively. When we start to break down barriers, what could we achieve? What could we do if we collectively committed to inspiring and empowering creatively? Imagine what's possible when we all begin to believe that there's potential in everyone, and that we strive, as Jim did, for a more fair, inclusive, and creative city. Jim knew that we could achieve things far beyond our own reach by simply working together. And so if you share our vision for 312 Main, if you have ideas, and you'd like to be part of Vancouver Center for Social and Economic Innovation, consider this an open invitation. We want to hear from you. This is only the beginning. The rest truly is up to you, Vancouver, with a little help and guidance from our friend. Thank you.